Hi, my name's Rupert Bottenberg. I'm the music editor at the Montreal Mirror News Weekly. I have been doing this job for 10 years now. Close to 10 years. Maybe more like 8. I'm not exactly sure. I haven't really counted. But I've been doing it a good long time. I thoroughly enjoy it. And I've lived in Montreal my entire life. And I'm very proud to be a Montrealer. The Montreal Mirror is a news weekly. Very much like The Village Voice, The Georgia Strait. I think just about every urban center of any degree of population concentration now has one of these news weeklies, which are advertising driven. They are distributed for free once a week, and the basis of them is the listings section. Their primary purpose is to let people know what's going on in the way of music, film, art, and so forth. These papers do also have a news angle to them, primarily local news. We don't generally write much about what's going on in the world outside of Montreal. On occasion we do, but our primary purpose is to let people know what's going on in Montreal from our point of view, what we think is cool, what we think is happening. What I do at the Montreal Mirror is I am the music editor, which means I not only write about music, that is, I write record reviews, I do interviews and write articles, and I also handle all the detailing of the section, putting in little photo captions, the little blurbs that go with the listings photos. I also have a bank of any number of freelance writers to whom I assign different interviews, different articles, different CDs to review, and then I get their work in. I edit it, which means I go through it for a certain degree factual errors, spelling mistakes, syntactical errors, basically whip it into shape to make it presentable for the reading public. There is a difference between being a music editor and being a music writer. The two do cross over, and in fact, in my experience doing my freelance work, being a music editor is of tremendous help in dealing with other editors. They're very thankful to work with somebody who's seen it from the other side, because there can be quite an antagonistic relationship between a freelance writer and an editor. Freelancers don't always seem to quite grasp the concept of deadlines, so on and so forth. Whereas my job as a music editor is to make sure that the machine flows smoothly. I do, however, still do quite a bit of writing, and in that case I'm able to go back to the experience of the music writer, which is, I think, a lot more fun. Being basically a lifelong Montrealer, and, you know, ever since my teens, being actively involved in the music scene in Montreal has been key to being the best music editor that I can be. Were I to, for instance, pack up my bags and move to another city, I don't think I'd do nearly as good a job, because to really put together a good music section for a paper, one has to have a strong sense of history. One has to have a strong sense of where things are going, and to know where things are going, you have to know where things are coming from. You have to understand who's who, who's done what are their backgrounds, rather than assessing people just on their on the face value of their latest project. Being able to put those projects in sort of a historical context gives one a much more clear idea of what's going on. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, having watched the scene here evolve and having been so actively involved in it, I can point out endless little nooks and crannies, people who have disappeared for years and then come back, so on and so forth, and sort of tie all of that together and give a larger picture, place the music in a larger but very Montreal-specific context. There has naturally been a great deal of chatter internationally about the so-called Montreal music scene explosion. I think what should be kept in mind is that there is a big distinction to be drawn between a music scene happening within the self-enclosed bubble of the city itself, and that scene being drawn to international attention. You know, there's that famous Andy Warhol thing, everyone gets their 15 minutes of fame, and Montreal has experienced its 15 minutes of fame. The famous Spin article, the famous New York Times article, which certainly generated a lot of contention among Montrealers. My way of thinking was, hey, you know, any publicity is good publicity. I think a lot of the people who registered disapproval of this were musicians who were snubbed and simply didn't get mentioned in these articles. I mean, that's, I think, inevitable in any scene. You know, there's that Morrissey song, there's a Smith song. We're always jealous when our friends become successful. The underlying idea being that if we're not successful too, there's something wrong with their success. So I was nothing but happy that finally the rest of the world was cluing in that something really exciting was happening here in Montreal. Now, prior to this kind of sudden burst of media attention that occurred maybe a year or two ago, there had certainly been a steady trickle of notable artists coming out of Montreal. In the mid-90s, early to mid-90s, there was Me, Mom, and Morgenthaler, kind of a ska, punk, carnival kind of band, modeled very much after French bands like Manon Negre. They weren't, I don't think they ever really caught on in the States, but they certainly made a name for themselves across Canada. There was also the Doughboys. You could go further back to April Wine, Pat Marino and Mahogany Rush, Leonard Cohen, so on and so forth. But in more recent years, you've had some very exciting developments in electronic music, be it Acufen on the sort of minimal house side, or Tiga on the sort of techno and more recently electro side of things. You've had Kid Koala, a really outrageously good turntablist in something, yeah, basically within the hip-hop milieu, even more so A-Track, who's been touring with Kanye West, also a Montrealer. You had all these various things coming out of Montreal, but I think what provoked the idea of a Montreal music explosion, quote-unquote, was this idea, and I've seen this before, where it takes several different acts, generally sort of somewhat comparable, all sort of blowing up big at the same time. You don't have a music explosion in a city when it's just one act. You know, nobody talked about the Asbury Park music explosion with Bruce Springsteen got big because it was just Bruce Springsteen, but in Montreal, you suddenly had this series of bands, almost like bang, 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 one, two, three. You had the Deers, you had the Stills, you had the Unicorns, and of course Arcade Fire, and their understudies Wolf Parade. All of these bands, one after the other, getting a great deal of attention in the rest of Canada, in the United States, in the UK and Europe. And so people started to realize, hey, there's something going on, there's something in the water in Montreal. Now, having been involved with this scene over the course of years and years and years, I can tell you that not only has this scene always been here, Montreal has always been a tremendously healthy city for creativity, for several reasons that I'll get into, but it's also a far more diverse musical scene than the big names would seem to suggest. I began doing comics, seriously, doing comics as opposed to simply doing illustrations, in early high school. I'd naturally been drawing quite a lot. Keep in mind that both of my parents are very involved in music. My father is a former, now retired, professor of classical music. They very much wanted me to be, if not a musician, at least involved in music. So they gave me basically years, from a very young age, years of private music lessons, which simply never took. However, at the same time, I was entirely on my own, much to the displeasure of my teachers in school, drawing a great deal. One thing that I really enjoyed drawing was character sketches for my friend's Dungeons & Dragons characters. I got a lot of practice that way. But sort of almost by chance, I went with my brother to a comic store. He was interested in buying some Marvel New Universe titles entirely for speculation, for collector's purposes. I wasn't interested in that. It seemed like a racket to me. But while I was there with him, I started flipping through a rack in the corner of what was called the alternates, or the alternative titles. A little bit comparable to what you'd call alternative rock. That is, stuff that didn't involve superheroes, that didn't involve, mostly didn't involve giant city-crushing robots, things like that. I'm actually quite fond of giant city-crushing robots. But that started to intrigue me and started to suggest to me that I could do something really exciting with the comics medium. I knew that I could draw, but I was excited about the idea of learning this entirely new discipline that combined drawing and also storytelling. So it was a combination of writing and and drawing. So it's almost like making little movies. In fact, the storyboards for films, that's how they start films, with storyboards, is very much like comics. It's taken me years. I only think that it's in recent years that I've really started to be content with what I've been doing with comics, that I was able to create comics that I felt were complete, that were entire, that were that weren't riddled with shortcuts and tricks and cheating to cover up my own weaknesses as a creator. My work is not explicitly political, nor does it have much grounding in what we would regard as the real world. I'm very disconnected from the autobiographical slice of life comics movement. That doesn't interest me at all. I think it's a medium, probably more so than any medium. It allows the fantastical and the imaginary to really come to the surface with tremendous ease. It's not a very expensive medium to create in. All it takes is pens and paper and some spare time. And it's not difficult to convince people that to draw people into sort of an imaginary world with this medium. So if I do have political and cultural points to make, and I think I do, I try to make them very subtly, almost unconsciously, that it comes forth intuitively. The idea of using comics, or of any, frankly, of any artistic medium, music, film, what be it, in too overt and clumsy a manner as a means of communicating strong political opinions, I think generally tends to backfire. There have been exceptions from the folk musician Phil Oakes, right through to, say, Billy Bragg, and in a way even, say, MIA, Maya Arunprogasam. What she does is absolutely fascinating. But the, you know, you look at something like Rage Against the Machine, and it's just so ham-fisted. You know, it actually drives me away from the political point they're trying to make. First of all, I'll explain what it is that makes Montreal such a good city to create in. And that, ironically, at this time, just as this Montreal music explosion has been taking place, rents have actually shot up in this city. Money is coming into this city, more people with jobs are coming into this city, real estate is now at much more of a premium. So one of the things that benefited creative people in Montreal the most over the course of the late 80s and right through the 90s was that the city, due in large part to political circumstances, first Bill 101 and then the 1995 referendum, the city took a huge punch economically over those stretches, which meant it was very difficult to sort of get ahead and make a good living in this town, but on the other hand, one could live dirt cheap. One could get apartments for a fraction of the cost of what they would be in Toronto or New York. One cannot underestimate how valuable that is to somebody who wants to pursue a creative career, because unlike going into, say, law, where you follow a very specific set of preset rules and you can almost sort of chart your career arc in advance, art doesn't work that way. Art is very intuitive. Art is very unpredictable. You don't know necessarily that what you create will connect with anyone out there. On the other hand, you could create something that suddenly connects ferociously well with people and bumps you up several notches on the sort of in the hierarchy of success. Another thing that's very essential, and this will lead to what I was talking about, the diversity of the community here. This is, of course, a bilingual city in which, I'm not even going to say bilingual, I'm going to say multilingual or polyglot. The two primary languages are, of course, first and foremost, French. I think it's about 70% of the population of Montreal is Francophone. The balance is primarily English-speaking, especially out in the Anglo enclave, the West Island, which is where I'm from. And then there's also naturally, there's been a huge influx of immigration over the past 20 years, which I think went a long way to sort of dampening down the tension between the English and French, as we started to realize that, for instance, the Latinos who were coming to Montreal were perfectly trilingual, speaking excellent English, excellent French, and also, naturally, their mother tongue of Spanish. We all started to get a little bit sort of embarrassed, you know, like, why am I fighting so hard for my rights to speak English when all other people are perfectly capable of speaking three languages? And I think that's actually produced something very healthy, what's going on right now in Montreal, is that, especially for people under the age of 30, I'm seeing more and more interaction between what used to be called les deux solitudes, or the two solitudes, the idea that the English and French, basically, we stop short of physically attacking each other, but we wanted very little to do with each other. That doesn't exist anymore. I find more and more interaction as we Anglos realize just what a valuable thing we have here, how we have access not only to our own essentially English, Protestant, North American culture, but also this other culture that people elsewhere in North America don't really have any direct access to. At the same time, the Francophones were realizing that simply shutting out the outside culture wasn't really benefiting them in any way. It wasn't benefiting them culturally or economically. And I think the most interesting and worthwhile people within the Francophone community have long since realized that being perfectly bilingual and being able to have connections and contacts and a cultural grasp of what's going outside of Montreal is really, really precious. So rather than wasting our energy fighting with one another, if we take those same energies and weave them together, we can create something much stronger and more powerful than can maybe be created elsewhere. And I think there is plenty of evidence for that to be found in these recent Montreal success stories, such as, for instance, The Deers. It's a perfectly bilingual band, half Francophones, half Anglophones. Arcade Fire also has Quebecois presence within it. And I don't know that these bands would have been able to become quite what they become without that really strong Francophone input. And I've been asked quite a lot, I've been interviewed quite a bit and asked quite a lot about the Montreal music scene, and I always make a strong point of pointing out just what is going on in the Francophone side of things, which gets very little attention, especially the more lyrically based music, which is sort of the lyrics being in French are beyond the grasp of most people outside of Montreal or outside of Quebec. Well, it's something interesting I've noticed about people in my line of work, working as music editors, is that, you know, it's the sort of thing that there isn't necessarily specific training for it, a specific course. I mean, one can actually take journalism courses, which I wouldn't advise against, if just to learn the basic technical rules of journalism and of writing. But I should point out now that I have no journalistic training. I studied creative arts and commercial art, commercial design, and also created a lot of comics. And I think working in those mediums did teach me some basic rules about creativity. And I think no matter what one goes into in terms of the creative arts, it's good to occasionally fool around in other mediums, if only to get a larger perspective on what the overarching rules of creativity are. And I think I'm right to use the word creativity in the context of music journalism. Creativity in the context of hard news journalism is as often as not lying or distorting the facts. However, music journalism being much more subjective, is the same sort of rules don't apply. So my best advice to a young person who's thinking, hey, I'd like to be a music editor, the first thing I tell them is, before you do that, spend a few years as a music journalist. It's very difficult to be an effective leader, because a music editor, you are basically a leader of a group of people. It's very difficult to lead anyone if you haven't at some point done what they're doing. To move on to the next level, to be a music editor, which still does involve some music writing, there are certain things one has to give up. You have to get used to the idea of getting up at a certain hour and putting certain hours in at the office. Some of the joys of freelance work, dragging your ass out of bed at noon, staying up all hours, keeping a weird schedule, being free to take off, leave the city for a couple of days if you want, this sort of thing. Those kind of evaporate when you take a job as an editor. But it does have its own rewards as well. You're sort of a meta-creator, in the sense that you're steering different creators around to make a larger creative whole. I'm overjoyed every week when I'm able to look at my music section and say, you know what, I did the best job I could. You know, I got all the right pieces in place and covered as much of Montreal's music scene as I felt was appropriate, and in the best way possible. naturally, there is always the possibility when you're in college or university of signing up with your student paper. That's a good training ground. In fact, I would advise anyone who wants to go into journalism of any sort to sign up with their student paper and just learn how that machine works, because there are a lot of technical considerations that I think people don't always realize when they come into the journalist environment. The deadlines, the things like word count, things like formatting, all these kind of things that are very, 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 very specific and very, very regimented. Because it's, you know, putting out a newspaper is, as much as anything, a technical process, the printing, the editing, so on and so forth. So to get a good grasp of that helps tremendously. I think another thing is also to sort of, as a writer, to try and explore things outside of music. Try writing about film now and then. Try writing about an art form. Hey, ideally an art form that you don't even like that much. Try writing about mime. Try interviewing a mime. Good luck. If only to give yourself sort of a perspective on your own skills, learn what you're best at and what your weaknesses are, and to get a better sense of how this process works. Because an editor is really about as much about sort of keeping the process flowing smoothly as it is about creativity.